Is our reality a simulation? An actual matrix? Can we finally prove there's life after death? And what about this alien UFO thing, really? There's a lot of cool, smart people working on this stuff, and I'm talking to them. Let's take the time to really explore bigger questions. I'm Ron James, and this is another edition of Bigger Questions. I'm very privileged to have with me in the studio Stanton Friedman. Stanton, thank you for being here.
My pleasure. Nice to be where it's warm instead of back where I live.
Stanton, I think I've told you this privately before, but I'll tell you while we're doing our show. When I first took an interest in this field, you were on television, and I was always amazed. You and Nick Pope and a couple other people that were always making the appearances and just seemed to have a really sane, rational voice in this field, which especially some consider becoming more and more rare. But, you know, I really looked up to you guys. And now, you know, I walk among you and I work with you and we do films together and we do things like this. And it's just very, very gratifying. You're best known as being the researcher that broke the Roswell story and brought it worldwide. But for you, it started way before that. Tell us about your journey.
It was 1958. I was a young nuclear physicist working for General Electric Aircraft Nuclear Propulsion Department in Cincinnati. And I'm a cheapskate. I was ordering books from a mail order house. I needed one more book so I wouldn't have to pay shipping. And there was the report on unidentified flying objects by Edward Ruppelt, who headed the old Air Force Project Blue Book in the early 50s. And it was marked down from $2.95 to $1, hardcover book. It wasn't going to cost me anything because that would have been shipping. So what the heck? I was interested. Also, there was a feeling that, gee, if these things are real, and I didn't have an opinion because I didn't know anything. I don't think it's good to have opinions when you don't know anything, at least not public ones. Maybe they're using nuclear power and it would help our program, you know, and wasn't costing me anything. And what could it hurt? $1, you know, it wasn't costing me anything because the shipping would have been that. So I read the book. It turns out in retrospect, it was a very lucky first book. It was a good introduction to the subject. Ruppelt was sensible. And it intrigued me. And I loaned the book to my neighbor. Charlie was an engineer 10 years older than I was. I had a lot of respect for him, and he was more impressed than I was, which impressed me. We each went our own way, and 10 years later, when he came to a lecture I gave in an electrical engineering group, first thing he said was, he and his wife were there, "We knew you when you didn't believe in flying saucers." That was gratifying. Anyway, I moved out to California, and my epiphany in the Bay Area came. I was at the University of California Library, and I'd read 10 more books by that time. And I suddenly found at the University of California Library, Berkeley, a copy of the biggest study ever done for the United States Air Force, Project Blue Book, Special Report Number 14. And I was surprised because it hadn't been mentioned in any of the books that I had read. And it was chock full of data. I'm a data hound. 200 charts, tables, graphs, maps. I was in data heaven. But it also had the press release, this was issued in 1955, it had the press release in which the Secretary of the Air Force lied through his teeth. That bothered the heck out of me. I was working under security. Sometimes you have to tiptoe around, you know, the reality and security and stuff like that.
Well, let me just stop you there and ask you, what were you doing that you can talk about as a nuclear physicist back then?
Well, then I was working at General Electric Aircraft Nuclear Propulsion Department. My field was radiation shielding. We had a big program. GE in 1958 spent $100 million. We employed 3,500 people, 1,100 of them engineers and scientists. I was working on shielding experiments. Shielding is a major problem because of the weight issue. Mm-hmm. So if you're going to have an effective nuclear aircraft, you got to be able to get it off the ground and fly, you know. So I did experiments down in Texas, out in Idaho, down in Oak Ridge and stuff. it was great. First job out of school, and I had a chance to take responsibility and working with exotic materials, gadolinium hydride and lithium hydride and other crazy stuff. So it was exciting. And I was working with sharp people, almost all older than I was, a lot of war veterans and stuff. This is in the 50s. So high tech, I found, was something that really interested me. And then after moving to California, where I was working on small reactors for space vehicle applications, nuclear reactors, I did worked on a study of fusion propulsion for deep space travel. That was exciting. And always, I worked on more canceled programs than anybody I know. It wasn't my fault, but.
Officially canceled or really canceled?
Oh, really canceled.
They really put it down.
Well, that's the way the business went. And I saw the light. I thought I'd worked for the same company for all my life. My dad worked for the same company for 37 years. And I looked at I could retire at age 57 from GE, and they had lots of nuclear groups, so it'd be great. I was young, And I saw the handwriting on the wall, and 16 months after I left, the whole project was shut down. The next program I worked on, more shut down. That was exciting. The fusion work was very exciting. People don't seem to understand that almost all the energy in the galaxy is produced by nuclear fusion. We think of it as H-bombs, but that doesn't do you much good if you're nearby. But the stars produce all their energy by nuclear fusion. So if you want to go to the stars, fusion is the likely choice. Just as the Navy has gone nuclear, people tend to forget. You could say it takes you 3 years to go around the planet because that's what it took Magellan's ship. But the space station does it in 95 minutes. So you got to change. The rule is that technological progress comes from doing things differently in an unpredictable way. And fusion is the way to go. But before you get to fusion, you try fission. The Navy demonstrated that. We got nuclear submarines. In World War II, a submarine could stay under for a day because you need air for the diesel engines, you see. A nuclear submarine can go around the world underwater, take periscope leave when you go by an island. That's what a Navy guy told me. That makes a big difference, you see. And that 1956, I think, the first nuclear submarine. And now we have nuclear-powered aircraft carriers. These are real, that can operate for 18 years without refueling. That's not just a little better than going to the gas station for fuel, in other words. So I also worked on nuclear rocket engines, fission rocket engines. That's what they use in the submarine aircraft carrier, nuclear fission. Mm-hmm. And I worked on a system nuclear rocket engine that was about this big in diameter, cylindrical system with a nozzle. And kind of a remarkable beast because you put in liquid hydrogen, very cold hydrogen, and you kick it out at over 4,000 degrees. And there's no oxygen, so the molecular weight is down, so the velocity is up. And if you use this for an upper stage for a rocket, like to go to Mars, for example, not a launch vehicle, but upper stage, you can double or triple your payload to Mars. We operated one this big. Power level was, the one I worked on for Westinghouse, was 1,100 megawatts. That's half the power of Hoover Dam, mm-hmm. Just this big. Now, Los Alamos built one, a little larger. Power level was 4,400 megawatts, twice the power of Hoover Dam in something this big. Then they canceled the program because nobody's decided to go to Mars.
Yeah, do they cancel these programs or do they just get close to answers and innovations and take them further underground when they determine a need?
No, they cancel them.
They cancel them.
It takes a lot of people and you have to have a mission. So what do you, with the Navy you got a mission, submarines, aircraft carriers, et cetera. And we're still using them and so forth. But with the space applications, there was a nuclear ramjet program. That was canceled. That's a way of life for all those parties. It was Cold War attitudes.
Sure.
We got to get there before the Russians do.
And everything was about nuclear at that point.
Well, it was the obvious choice as opposed to gasoline or diesel fuel, you know. So it was exciting to work on these programs. And I did a study, one-man operation, for the Foreign Technology Division of the Air Force, which is where Project Blue Book, the Air Force UFO study, was being conducted as well. And I love the title. Analysis and Evaluation of Fast and Intermediate Reactors for Space Vehicle Applications. One important word was left out, Soviet. I was evaluating because I knew what we were doing. Mm-hmm. Are the Russians working on nuclear power plants for space applications? Because it gives you a source of power for a long time, small weight. Hey, that's right. The way to go. And so I put out two final reports. One was a listing of all their research in different areas of technology and physics and stuff. And the other was my conclusions. I don't even have a copy of the conclusion study. That one was classified. And I correctly predicted, I am free to say now, that the Russians would be putting nuclear power plants in space, which is interesting because the only time it got any noise was they had one. Their idea was to put up the nuclear power plant in space, small device to produce a lot of energy for a long time. And the idea was there was a rocket on board which would boost it into a higher orbit. And you don't need to worry about it. It's up there cooking away, so what? Well, the rocket didn't work one time, and Cosmos 954 came down in northern Canada. Well, a lot of radiation being released, and people worried about the caribou. It was in an area, Great Slave Lake, where there aren't many people.
Right.
None of the press coverage mentioned that this was like the 13th Soviet nuclear power plant in space. The United States had put up one. And they wound up, the Russians put up over 30 of them. And so everybody was worried about the radiation. The important thing was that the Russians had capability in space from orbit that we didn't have for a laser beam weapon or particle beam weapon or sideband radar. Great to have all that power that you couldn't get from a solar plant. And solar doesn't work very well if you're in the shadow of the Earth and stuff because it intercepts the sun and so forth. So I was very pleased. I must have been the only person pleased in the country that the Russians wanted crash because it says I was right.
Wow, so you actually predicted that they were going to do that and it turned out later that they
hadn't. The United States actually bought one from them downstream a year or two.
Yeah, that must have been in friendlier times.
Yeah, they needed the money.
So you were you're an educated scientist with a logical mind, and you got a hold of the book, and it began to pique your curiosity.
Yeah, and once I found out that the Secretary of the Air Force was lying, which bothered me, I'd talk about it at lunch and stuff with my colleagues, and switched jobs. I wound up in Indianapolis, where Frank Edwards was. He had written a best-selling book, Flying Saucer Serious Business.
Now tell us about exactly what the lie was and how you knew it was real.
Secretary Donald Quarles, Secretary of the Air Force now, this wasn't some dink. The press release said, he said, was quoted as saying, on the basis of this study, we believe that no objects such as those properly described as flying saucers have overflown the United States. Even the unknown 3% could have been identified as conventional phenomena or illusions if more complete observational data had been available. Well, that seems to take care of the problem nicely. Well, I had the report, and I'm a data hound. What's he talking about? The unknowns were 21.5%. And they were completely separate from the sightings listed as insufficient information. So that was a lie. They did other things. They found the better the quality. All this work was done by scientists working for Battelle Memorial Institute. But it wasn't mentioned in the press release. Didn't say where the work was done. Didn't give the title of the report. Surely if they had said Blue Book Special Report Number 14, somebody would have said, hey, what happened to 1 through 13? We've never heard anything about them. Mm-hmm. They were classified. But so that bugged me. Also, they asked an obvious question. Well, two of them you can think of. They did a quality evaluation of all the sightings based on the background of the observer, the circumstances, that sort of thing. The better the quality, the more likely to be unexplainable. I'm only interested in the unexplained ones.
Right.
They also asked an obvious question. Is there really any difference between the unknowns and the knowns based on six different observables, apparent size, color, shape, speed? Maybe the two groups just matched and we missed the boat on our evaluation.
Right.
The probability that the unknowns were just missed knowns was less than 1%. So where do they get off with these lies? That's what bugged me. And it was, you know, luncheon conversation, brown bagging it with colleagues kind of thing.
Sure.
Then I moved to Indianapolis after another canceled program and met Frank Edwards, whose book, Flying Saucer Serious Business, was a bestseller. Frank was a journalist. He knew people everywhere.
Now, this topic was getting a lot more mainstream attention back then, starting with the sightings and Kenneth Arnold and all that.
Well, that's when things started. Kenneth Arnold's sighting on June 24th, 1947. And I didn't know about Roswell until the late 70s, and that was in first part of July 1947. But I gave my first lecture. Well, it really started with because of Frank. I moved to Pittsburgh to work for Westinghouse Astronuclear Lab on nuclear rocket engines. And I asked Frank for the names of people. I wanted to go public. I was sick and tired of seeing lies and stuff like that. So he gave me some names. He knew everybody. And I called the big television station in Pittsburgh, and radio, it's television and radio, KDKA, famous station. And he gave one of the people he told me about was the producer of a program called Contact, great program, talk show. And I called them, and their response was, don't call us, we'll call you, basically, which surprised me, because in Pittsburgh, a nuclear physicist working for Westinghouse, those were gold-plated credentials.
Right.
Westinghouse is very big in Pittsburgh. So, okay, less than a month later, he called me. At 6:30, could I do the 7 o'clock show, please? Somebody had canceled.
Oh, wow.
And I've never known how many people they tried before they got to me, but I lived not far from the station. So, okay, I can do it. That was my first show. Somebody at work at Westinghouse on the nuclear rocket project had a book review club, and they were reading Frank's book. And she asked me to speak to their club. That was my first lecture in her living room. So I enjoyed it, and I did that show again several times. I got better at it. And I did more lectures. And then one day, things happen in strange ways. I lived downtown Pittsburgh. The Westinghouse was out of town a bit. It was in a small town called Large. And I'm riding to work one of two times in 3 years with Joanne, a supervisor at Westinghouse. And I was saying, gee, I'd like to speak at Carnegie Tech. Well, talk to the dean, Stan. I said, well, I talked to Dr. So-and-so, and he wasn't interested. He said, Stan, the dean's my husband. He's heard you on the radio. Why don't you give him a call? Okay. So I called him, and we booked a talk. But it was an afternoon talk for about 3 weeks later. And the last question was, how much do you want? Well, I knew I'd have to take some time off work, being a pragmatist. Maybe $100? This is back in 1967, you understand. Sold. But because I knew his wife, he told me what he was paying the other speakers in the series, $1,600, $1,500, $1,700.
Really? Back then, that was a lot of money.
Yeah. And the nice thing was the lecture went very well. And so the dean wrote the agent through whom he had booked the other speakers, recommended me, and they booked me at the Engineering Society of Detroit for $300 in expenses. Wow, I'm in a big time. They were sold out 3 weeks in advance for 1,008 people for dinner and a talk, and there wasn't one negative question. And the strange little side comment here, the agent who booked me is a guy named Bob Walker, and he works for American Program Bureau. I just got finished this very day lecturing at a conference in San Diego which was booked by Bob Walker.
Wow.
The person I dealt with was so surprised. This is when, you know, back in 67, Bob's still there and I'm still going strong. Small world. Anyway, I did a lot more professional groups. And then they canceled the nuclear rocket program. Not because we hadn't succeeded. We had succeeded. The rockets worked. But sure. Nobody wanted them.
It was right. That too much risk, right?
No program, no goal, no, you know, we went to the moon because a goal was set and everything was aimed toward that. So then I was looking for a job.
Wait, let's talk about nuclear rockets for a second, take a little sidebar. So you guys had actually developed working nuclear rockets?
Well, we tested them at the nuclear test site near Las Vegas, not far from Area 51, you know. And we didn't know how long they would work. It was the most exciting part of my professional career. And we're listening over the PA system at Westinghouse. We had a closed system. And how long would it work? The maximum was 60 minutes because we needed to have liquid hydrogen to cool it, because the more you operate, the more radioactive it becomes, the more energy it produces. Sure. And you don't want it to melt. Not a good idea.
Right.
And 5 minutes, the temperatures were nominal, pressures were nominal, 10 minutes, 15 minutes. We thought maybe the fuel elements would kick right out the nozzle. The temperatures were over 4,000 degrees. Not many things operate at those temperatures, sure. You know. So we went the full 60 minutes. And boy, were we happy. And then the program got canceled shortly thereafter because there was no goal for it. Okay, so you guys can do it. We don't want it.
Sure. And I'm sure that a lot of people already know the answer to this question, and I'm sure that I should probably know it too, but why has the nuclear rocket capability not been brought more into current?
Because we don't have a mission for it. We're not going to Mars, last I heard anyway, and it's expensive.
Well, I mean, according to Boeing, they've developed, you know, some of the major components for going to Mars. That new capsule, the Orion, I think it is supposed to be Mars ready. And they're advertising now about how, you know, they just need to build a few more different components and they're going to be ready to go.
But they're not using nuclear as far as I know.
And do you
somebody
know why?
Has to decide.
I mean, is it a safety issue or is it a...
It takes guts. Admiral Rickover had guts. He led the Navy
to even
nuclear
think about
program.
Something like that, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. And I'm sure, you know, I co-authored a book called Science Was Wrong. 14 chapters, my co-author and I each wrote 7. Each one stimulated by some very bright guy who said it's impossible, said some stupid things. And that, well, a great astronomer said that man would never fly in an airplane 2 months before the Wright brothers' first flight.
Right.
Another one in 1956, a year before, Sputnik said space travel is utter bilge. Nobody's ever going to pay for that. Next year, Sputnik went up. You know, so there are these bright people who say things are impossible. They're always around. That's why when I mentioned Rickover, he was a dynamic, this is where we're going. If you don't want to go there, get off the train. You know, and some people hated his guts.
Right.
But you have to persist. It takes leadership and knowledge and an ability to manipulate people and get them to get the darn job done, you know. So I'm anxious to see how things go. You know, private industry is getting into the space thing. And I think that's when things will take off.
That's why I'm so curious about the rocket situation, because, like, you know, SpaceX is like a block away from us right now. And the civilian movement towards getting more and more of the government contracts, then of course the civilian and business incursion into space becoming more and more in the limelight. I've always been led to believe that there was some kind of a really fundamental reason why nuclear rocketry was never going to be an option.
It should always be an option, but it takes guts to let's do it. Look, the battleship guys didn't like Rickover building nuclear submarines or aircraft carriers. I mean, battleships, that's what we need. So it's a dynamics of personality, if you will. You need a pioneer, a gutsy pioneer. And one thing about Rickover, a little side comment, but he was Jewish. That meant he couldn't join the country clubs all those other things, admirals. He was a rear admiral, not a full admiral. And so his decision was to be a darn good engineer. That's where he was getting his satisfaction. Not everybody is geared that way. They want to make it up the ladder, you know, climb to the top. Not by accomplishment, but by being careful and politically right. And so he got things done. He wasn't politically right. It's like Billy Mitchell was court-martialed. He flew in the First World War, and he saw, he was a man of vision, that airplanes would be very important in battle. But when he said that we're going to sink ships from planes, the Secretary of the Navy said, I'll stand on any ship. He says he's going to sink. You can't do that. And interestingly enough, on November 29th, 1941, it was the Army-Navy game, football game, big deal. And in the program, there was a picture of the USS Arizona. And it said nobody had ever sunk a ship from the sky. 8 days later was Pearl Harbor, and it went to the bottom there. 1,100 right. men died.
Yeah.
The Japanese knew you could sink a ship from the sky.
Yeah, and they proceeded to do it again and again.
Yeah. So it's a personality, attitude. How do you get the job done? That's what the problem is.
Well, you know, the recent Virgin Atlantic crash that killed the pilot, I was having a conversation with Steve Bassett, and we were talking about why, if there's all this technology that's available, and we'll get into, you know, supposed advanced technology of extraterrestrial origin later, but even something like nuclear rocketry that could have advance this civilian spaceflight cause without the need for all these. They're trying to remix rocket fuels and come up with new ways to fuel rockets. And if we have this technology, why aren't they going down that road?
No guts, no leadership. Look, if we left the government run the computer business, there'd be four companies, there wouldn't be much difference in the computers, and they would have 1/100th of the capacity we have now, because some businesses failed. There was competition.
Right.
And the winners did well.
Well, that's why NASA is allowing, enthusiastically allowing other companies to take
yeah,
some
get
of
them
the
off
reins.
The hook.
Yeah, yeah,
yeah.
It's really
so
interesting.
Somebody ought to do a study on the dynamics of the utilization of nuclear energy for advanced technology. I mean, people are shocked when I say the carriers, the aircraft carriers, can operate for 18 years. Well, you're kidding. No, I'm not kidding. It's real.
It's true.
But you're not using the Queen Elizabeth with nuclear power.
So here you are. You had gotten the book. You realized that there was obviously some sort of cover-up going on just in what you learned from Project Blue Book against what you already knew to be the truth. And then you began to talk to groups and lectures, and you joined some organizations. So, you know, they say this field is like once you get in, it's really hard to get back out because you learn more and more, and you realize that there's a mystery and an enigma and quite possibly a variety of conspiracies.
And a cover-up.
Yeah. So
Cosmic
so
Watergate.
So you move forward, truth embargo. So when did you first get an inkling that something was happening with Roswell?
It was purely by accident. I was in Baton Rouge, Louisiana, to give a lecture at Louisiana State University. And people from the university had brought me over to the local television station, CBS. And I was supposed to do three interviews, three different time slots. And I did the first two, and the third reporter was nowhere to be found. This is in 1978. Nobody had cell phones. I mean, they couldn't just call her. And so the station manager's giving me coffee, he's looking at his watch, he knows that I've got it, because he knew the people who brought me there, that I had things to do. Out of the blue, he says, you know, the guy you ought to talk to is Jesse Marcel. Brilliant investigator that I am. I said, who's he? His answer changed my life. He handled wreckage of one of those saucers you were interested in when he was in the military. What? You know, where'd that come from? I don't know anything about that. What do you know about him? He lives in Houma. I didn't know where Houma, Louisiana was. I've been there since to talk to Jesse.
Sure.
And he's a great guy. World ham radio buddies. You ought to talk to him. Then the reporter showed up. End of conversation. I go off to do all the things I had to do that day. And things went very well that night at the auditorium at the university. So the next day I was at the airport early, and I thought, you know, I ought to, because of the enthusiastic response, mm-hmm. I had a call, see if I can find this Jesse Marcel, called information, you know, the old-fashioned way of doing things.
Yeah, 411 and directory assistance.
Yeah, there was no internet at that time, for those who think that that's how you do things, you know. And there was a number for Jesse, so I called him. I told him I'd been talking to Bill Allen. Oh, yeah, ham radio stuff. And I found out later, incidentally, Jesse had never really told him anything. He asked him once and just said, I can't talk about that. He knew about it because he saw the article in the paper in July of 1947. And back then, if you
took... The original article?
About Roswell.
Okay.
Army captures flying saucer on ranch in Roswell region, you know. And back then, if you talked about military guys, you often put their hometown in the article, just for identity purposes. And the TV guy had seen the article in the New Orleans newspaper. And it mentioned Houma, Louisiana. So later on, he asked Jesse about it. He says, I can't tell you anything about that. So just by chance, because that reporter was late, thank goodness, that got me rolling. Okay, when I talked to Jesse, he was the intelligence officer for the 509th, the only atomic bombing group in the entire world, most elite military group in the world.
Yeah, you know, a lot of people don't understand that, that his position was not, you know, on some obscure base. He was in a very high position, in a very trusted high security position with a very elite, very important group
within
the military.
That's what he was. And so he told me his story. He was the duty officer on a Sunday, and he gets a call from the sheriff. A rancher had come in and talked to the sheriff. Now, the rancher hadn't heard about flying saucers. But when he went to do his shopping, weekly shopping in Corona, tiny little town, he was complaining about, he found all this debris on his ranch. He'd heard an explosion a few days before. Goes out there, and here's all this stuff strewn across an area 3/4 mile long, 1/4 mile wide, foil-like material and other stuff. And he was worried about who's going to clean it up, because he was a sheep ranch. And sheep will eat almost anything, give them half a chance. And that's not good for them,
right?
You know. So that's what he, and also they wouldn't cross the debris field to get to the water. This is desert we're talking about. You know, water is important kind of thing. And so he's complaining to his buddies in Corona. And they had seen articles about flying saucers. Because after Kenneth Arnold's sighting, which was only 2 weeks earlier, there were hundreds of sightings all over the country. And an article mentioned that there was a reward being offered for pieces of one. They said, you ought to go to the sheriff's office and collect a reward. He had brought some stuff into the Corona place. And so on that Sunday, he went to Roswell, the sheriff's office. And the sheriff, by prearrangement, called the base. Anything that could affect the base, the sheriff was supposed to let them know, whether it was a drunken airman or an accident or anything like that. Sure. They wanted good relations with the town. Roswell's a small town. A lot of people worked at the base. Jesse talked to his boss, Colonel Blanchard, and went to the sheriff's office and looked at this crazy stuff. And Jesse had served in the Pacific. He had seen airplane crashes. And, you know, normally there's a big hole in the ground. And you find standard wreckage. You find wires. You find vacuum tubes back then. Notes that say made in Oshkosh or, you know, tags and stuff like that. It was nothing conventional. He told me this in the first conversation. It wasn't anything conventional out there. And he figured it had to be an above-ground explosion because it covered such a large area and because there was no crater. When an airplane goes in, you make a big hole in the ground, you know. So he looks at the stuff, he talks to Colonel Blanchard, he says, take one of our counterintelligence corps guys with you. They're worried about who's spying. This is a nuclear weapons center, the only one.
So when he first told you about the debris, did he describe it? Because, you know, they tried to pass it off, obviously, as Project Mogul, weather balloon, nothing but lightweight materials and foil.
Yeah, he did describe it enough to say the Mogul explanation came forward later.
Way later, yeah.
But he told me the stuff was extremely lightweight, very strong. One of his guys had a piece of it, put it on a rock on one end of the ground and hit it with a sledgehammer, couldn't dent it. It was peculiar. Nothing conventional. And so
was there mechanics and machinery that he talked about as well? I mean, this was back when, this was one of the first times that Jesse is actually really telling this story to an investigator in such a way
that
it's going to be documented. So were there elements of how he described the debris that really stuck with you?
Yes, maybe extraordinarily lightweight, extraordinarily strong. Later when I talked to his son, showed an I-beam that had a simulated I-beam that had strange symbols on it and that you couldn't break, couldn't cut, couldn't burn. This is peculiar, and it certainly wasn't neoprene from weather balloons. Jesse had taken a course. He briefed pilots. They ran missions from Roswell, big B-36s, huge airplanes. And he'd have to do the weather reports and give them directions. And so he was familiar with weather balloons. All the ranchers were familiar with weather balloons. They released them every day at the base. Neoprene weather balloons will turn to dust if they're out in the sun for any length of time. This is New Mexico, you know, it's dry and hot, good combination. So they go out, the boss, Colonel Blanchard, tells them, follow the rancher out. Because the ranchers told them, there's loads of this stuff out there, not just the stuff that I brought in. If all there was just, somebody said in one of the articles, just enough to fit in the trunk. That's nonsense. They would have brought it in and that would have been the end of it. It's a 75-mile drive, part of it off-road, in the middle of nowhere, and no AAA out there, you know. So the counterintelligence corps guy was because he wondered who's spying on us. We know now that the Russians had spies at Los Alamos in New Mexico. And certainly we were flying rockets, German rockets, in New Mexico at White Sands Missile Range. And naturally, the Russians would want to keep track of that. The Cold War had already started. This wasn't a thought in the future kind of thing. So they went out there following the rancher, because no way to tell anybody how to get there. You can't go six blocks that way and four blocks that way. It's in the middle of nowhere. So he let them stay in their sleeping bags in a shed. The next day they go out to the debris field and he sees all this stuff. And they filled the vehicles with it, leaving most of it there. But the idea was to bring it back. He stops at his home on the way back, shows it to his 11-year-old son, Jesse Jr., who went on to be a medical doctor, a flight surgeon, got called back in at age 68 and flew 225 combat hours in the Middle East as a helicopter pilot. Flight surgeons were hard to come by. He died last year, a very special guy. I was in his home and in his dad's home. He lived in Helena, Montana. His dad lived in Louisiana, Houma. Anyway, he shows his son this stuff. Then he takes it into the base the next morning. Now it's beginning to get classified. See, up to that point, who said anything about security? Who knows what this junk is? You know, that attitude. And the next day, Colonel Blanchard tells him to use one of our B-29s, have them take you and this wreckage to our headquarters, 8th Air Force headquarters in Fort Worth, Texas. They were part of the 8th Air Force, the only nuclear part, you understand. And so naturally everybody does what they're supposed to do. When he gets there, General Ramey, who's Colonel Blanchard's boss, says, you don't say anything. I'll take care of it. And they take the wreckage that he brought in, that goes over there. They bring in the wreckage of weather balloon radar reflector combinations and tell the press, a press release had been put out in Roswell by Walter Hout.
Right.
Army captures flying saucer on ranch in New Mexico kind of thing. And they pull a fast one. Nobody knew. There weren't any pictures taken of that stuff that made it out into the public. So who knew? And Jesse was told not to say anything. And his picture appeared in newspapers all over. And his name was all over the place. And I mention that because people say, well, why did he talk to you? His name was all over the place. I didn't know that at the time.
Right.
It was only later when we got a date, and I shared this with a colleague, and he looked at the University of Minnesota newspapers and found the story. and verified what Jesse said.
So when you first talked to Jesse Marcel, he acknowledged to you that that photo was faked?
It was a genuine photo of the wrong material.
Right, exactly.
Yes.
That's what I mean.
Yes.
So he was an active participant in that deception at the time.
Hey, he was given instructions by Ramey. You follow orders. This is 1947.
Right.
He wasn't West Point. Blanchard was. And look, there are people who will tell you that, oh, Colonel Blanchard, he was a loose cannon. As it happens, he got four more promotion, was a four-star general and vice chief of staff of the Air Force when he died of a massive heart attack at the Pentagon. This wasn't a dink. You don't get four promotions.
Right.
Just for being a good-looking guy.
So the press release came out. There was a worldwide distribution of this news that the Army had recovered a flying saucer. And then the very next day, they show up with fake debris, and General Ramey, to quote the famous headline, empties flying saucer story. So,
well, there's another part of the story that I didn't know at the time. Nobody knew. There are three people in those pictures: General Ramey, his adjutant or whatever you want to call him, Colonel Thomas Jefferson Dubose, also West Point. Well, I found out, and I knew Ramey was dead. I knew Blanchard was dead. But maybe Dubose. Let's see if he's still alive. I called West Point. I figured he probably was West Point, because most of the people who weren't West Point, the officers, got out after the end of the war. That was in 45. So West Point told me that he was still alive and in Florida. He didn't give me an address, but with a name like Thomas Jefferson Dubose, I was able to find him, called him, arranged. My parents had retired in Florida, so I was going to Florida anyway. I stopped by to see him near Orlando, Winterport. Friendly guy. And one of the things he told me, and he's actually on film, we filmed him for a DVD, Recollections of Roswell. More than 20 firsthand witnesses, all of whom are now dead, incidentally, so you can't redo those. And he tells me he took the call from Ramey's boss, General McMullen in Washington, acting head of Strategic Air Command, really. Giving him three orders. Just didn't appear in the press at all at the time. One, get the press off our back. I don't care how you do it. In other words, if you want to lie, go ahead. Second, send some of that wreckage up here today with one of your colonel couriers from Fort Worth to Washington. And three, I don't want you ever to talk about this again, not even with your buddy Roger Ramey. That's an order. Do I need to put it in writing, Colonel? They knew each other.
Right.
West Pointers and so forth. No, sir, don't need to put it in writing. When a two-star general tells a colonel what to do, he does it. People say, why didn't he complain? This is 2 years after the war, you don't complain. You follow the chain of command. So it was nice to get that on record with Dubose before he died. I don't know how to reach him once they die, you know.
That's a whole other field.
Yes. Things went on. The story was ended by the press. You know, Ramey empties Roswell saucer, as you said. And I'm talking 30 years later, roughly. We started to look. Because I shared this information with Bill Moore, who went to the University of Minnesota, which had American newspapers, he had a story about an English actor, Huey Green, whom I talked to by phone, incidentally. It was in the Flying Saucer Review, an English publication, and he said he was driving from Los Angeles to Philadelphia when he heard on the radio about a crashed saucer in New Mexico. And he could pin down the date, because it wasn't a trip you made very often. You can imagine what the roads were like
in
1947. And so Bill went to the University of Minnesota Library, going through the newspapers. He said first week in July, found the story. Named a lot of people, including Walter Hout, the press guy, and other names. And so we proceeded, let's see who we can find. Well, I got lucky. I looked in editor and publisher, found that Roswell indeed, I didn't know anything about Roswell. It's in the desert in New Mexico.
Right.
Indeed had a newspaper. I called the Roswell Daily Record. Tell a gal I'm looking for the editor from 1947, this is 1978, long gone, what do you need? Well, I've got the story here that says the base public information officer, I didn't know the base had been closed for years now, a guy named Walter Howe taught, his name is spelled four different ways in those articles that I had. And before I could finish the sentence, she says, oh, his wife works here. What? You don't expect that. Walter's from Chicago.
Wow.
What the heck is he doing in Roswell in 1978? He likes the place, it turns out. So I found Walter, and he had a base yearbook, and he was a great help, one of the founders of the museum in Roswell and stuff, in remembering people. He knew Jesse, remembered the incident. And a point that needs to be made. There's one debunker who says, oh, an anonymous public information officer made up this unauthorized story and put out the press release. Sorry. Walter was a World War II bombardier. He was close to Colonel Blanchard. He flew more than 20 missions over Japan. And when they ran a series of tests of two more atomic bombs in 1946, Operation Crossroads in the Pacific, they wanted to find their effect on ships, which they didn't know. They had Hiroshima and Nagasaki.
You know? Right.
Walter was chosen to drop the instrument package. You pick your best people to do that because you don't want to waste an atomic bomb when we didn't have many and not get measurements. That's the whole point, you know. So Walter was not anonymous. His name was in all the books, but the investigator, this debunker, hadn't read any of the books. He made it up as he went along. That kind of thing gets me down. Give me the facts. That's what I want. That's evidence, data sort of thing. So we proceeded with Walter's help. We found 62 people within a year and a half from the base, for the yearbook helped. And first book came out in 1980, The Roswell Incident by Charles Berlitz and William L. Moore, and I was to get a special, I got a percentage of the royalties because Bill and I did most of the work. By 1986, we had found 30 more people. And I convinced Unsolved Mysteries, a major television program, mm-hmm. met with them, convinced them to do a segment, and they did. It was seen by 27 million people. This was before cable.
Sure.
So, you know,
yeah,
and because
I was one of them.
Because I had suggested it, they gave me access to some of the people who wrote in, dozens of people said, oh, Uncle Joe told me that, Uncle Bill, Cousin John, etc. So we got access to more witnesses, and my book came out later than that, Crash at Corona.
Right.
They loved me in Corona because they used to have a sign at the 50th anniversary, forget about Roswell, it all happened here.
Well, you know, anything to keep a bar going.
Yeah, and so it took a lot of work. Remember, this is before the internet.
Right.
My phone bills and Bill's phone bills were running hundreds of dollars a month. But what do? You want to find people? And got lucky, I called information in New Mexico. I'm looking for anybody named Brazel. That was the rancher's name.
Right, Mac Brazel.
Yeah. And she says, what city? And I said, I don't know, southeastern New Mexico, that's all. Okay, oh, I've got a William Brazel here in Carrizozo. Is that in southeastern New Mexico? Yes. Okay, well, it turns out he'd gotten his phone just 2 weeks before that. Bill had tried unsuccessfully because he didn't have his phone yet.
Right.
So I found the rancher's son. He was alive. The rancher was dead, so I couldn't talk to him. And we worked at it. And it was challenging to find people and to check back with Walter if he remembers this guy or that guy. And it's kind of funny. When you ask somebody, wondering what you remember about what happened in 1947. You were at the base, Roswell Army Airfield. Oh, yeah. Do you remember anybody else who was there at the time? Well, no, you know, it's a long time ago. Well, you keep him in that time frame. And pretty soon he says, did you talk to William Smith? He was there at the time. I remember him now. And you can get four or five names from a guy who first says, I don't remember anyway. Well, you know, 30 years, that's understandable. You know, who did you go to high school with 30 years later? It takes a while to regurgitate the memories. So we found all those people, and the books came out. And then, of course, there were some phony people, but at the 50th anniversary of Roswell, 1997, there were over 300 accredited newsmen there for the celebration. And they've been having festivals every year since. It's very popular. Now, you have to understand, Roswell isn't on the way to anywhere. It's 200 miles from Albuquerque, 200 miles from Amarillo, 200 miles from El Paso. If you're there, it's because you want to be there.
Right.
And the museum is there. And thousands of people come. And they have a parade and costume contests and lectures. I'll be given three lectures or four, I don't know which, this year. And several other respectable people there. And you sit at your vendor table and people want to take their picture with you and stuff. But look, I've lectured in 18 countries. And everybody wants to, and 50 states and 10 provinces, everybody wants to know about Roswell. It's really become a very famous thing. And it seems quite appropriate that Roswell should benefit from this covered up situation, because New Mexico didn't vote for Lyndon Johnson in the 1964 election. So pretty soon, he closed the base for no good reason. He moved it to Texas, of all places. It's got a 13,000-foot runway there, which is huge if you go checking around. And great flying weather, no mountains close by. Great.
Yeah, well, they're putting it to good use today.
Well, yeah, they are. But it seems appropriate somehow that since the government stuck a knife in the back of the base, so to speak, that they benefit. The town, you know, they're a major tourist attraction. And like I said, it's on the way to any place. And Albuquerque, you go through east, west, you know, people are always going through there.
You can go to Roswell, you can see the hangar,
you can go to the museum,
out to the place.
You can see my picture on the wall of the museum,
yeah,
you know.
Yeah,
so they've won awards as a tourist attraction and stuff. So yes, you can say it's a whole industry, but there's firsthand information, especially earlier on when the people were still alive. And at first, the town or people, city fathers, you want us to be the UFO capital of the world. What are you, crazy? And then in a couple of years after the people showed up, you know, if you build it, they'll come.
Right.
They talked about moving it a mile away, not on Main Street.
Oh,
No. we need you there. Hey, they have the light posts with alien eyes on, you know. Even Walmart has a sign, aliens welcome.
Yeah. It's the one Walmart where you can go and buy a whole collection of alien stuff. It's pretty funny.
Yeah. So, and I've been in the parade and you wave at the kids and stuff. And I see nothing wrong with that. If people are going to bring their kids, you got to have something for them to get interested
right.
in, you know. So, yes, it's become an industry, a household name all over the world. And I'm very pleased that I was the initial guy to bring it forward.
The MJ-12 papers that popped up, you're on the record as believing that they're genuine.
Three are genuine and there's 100 phonies.
Okay.
You flood the market with garbage. Hopefully people will say, well, this is garbage and this is garbage, so that must be garbage too. And I've recently published a list of 12 different objections to the documents and shown that none of them held up. And 10 different pieces of information that weren't known to be true when we got the documents that turned out to be true later. There's a special, the memo from Truman to Secretary of Defense Forrestal mentions Forrestal and Vannevar Bush, who was the top scientist in technical stuff related to military things. The date of that is the one day in an 8-month period where Truman, Bush, and Forrestal met. How did a hoaxer know that? I asked the people at the Truman Library. Did anybody else ever ask you this question? No. That's typical. There are a whole bunch of these little tidbits.
Little pieces of information that coincided and could not have happened any other way.
Yeah, and the whole Menzel thing, everybody was shocked. I was shocked. I didn't like the guy when he was alive. I find a letter, he and Jack Kennedy knew each other because Kennedy was on the Board of Overseers at Harvard, picked astronomy as his area of interest. And he writes to Kennedy, and I found this in the Harvard archives. There's one area where I may be able to help you considerably. This is the election year for Kennedy, and then after that. That's about the National Security Agency. I had a long, continuous history with them and the Navy intelligence predecessor, 30 years. When we are properly cleared to each other, this is what he says to Kennedy, I can tell you more. And he did work for the CIA. All this came as a total shock. just by accident, somebody picked his name. That's ridiculous. Nobody went to Harvard to show that I was wrong. I published copies of letters and all this stuff. It's been an exciting chase. Some people don't want to believe that there's stuff going on that we didn't know about. Gee, what a surprise. But I worked under security. These guys didn't. I mean, you know, one of the objections, this illustrates the intellectual bankruptcy of the pseudoscience of anti-ufology. A guy named Phil Klass, who was a total debunker.
Right.
Maybe you didn't notice that the typeface on this other document here was the large pica type, but the National Security Council, which is mentioned by its initials, used only a elite type. He challenged me to find any other examples of the use of the large pica type meeting certain criteria, and I'll pay you $100 each up to a maximum of 10. Now, he'd never been to the Eisenhower Library. I've spent literally weeks there. And I was going, so I dug out 14 of these documents, sent him copies and an invoice, and he sent me the $1,000. But there's no Friedman file in the class papers at the American Philosophical Society Library where they got loads of his materials, but nothing about me, even though we corresponded for 20 years. But he'd never been there. The notion that you can take 9 documents, which is all he had, the Eisenhower Library had 250,000 pages of National Security Council material. Utterly irrational. I get a good laugh when I show a copy of his check to me to presume that you can jump from a, you know, 200,000 or more pages till they're all done with the same typewriter. People, I hope, still know what typewriters are. You know?
So almost from the time you really went public with your suppositions about Roswell and reporting those facts through the MJ-12 papers and on to other things.
That was late '84. No, I started in '78. So.
Right. So you've been embroiled in controversy and really back and forth, prove this, prove that. And it kind of reflects what's really happening in the field of ufology, where there seemingly would be a lot of people on the same page trying to accomplish the same task, but it's not really that way. It's more of an infighting kind of family.
Research by proclamation instead of research by investigation. That's what I object to. If you're going to say I'm wrong, show me.
Right.
I will show you why you are wrong, I will say to the debunkers. And, you know.
So you're pretty confident with your position on the MJ-12 papers.
And yes.
Then we move forward to what's the next real controversy that you stepped into between your research and what others were trying to point out or not be?
Well, there's the general. There's one big general area, and that is that you can't get here from there. I hear that all the time from the ancient academics and fossilized physicists. You know, have you forgotten the speed of light's a limit and all this kind of stuff? Well, unlike any of these guys, I worked on a fusion propulsion study back in 1962. I do know that with nuclear fusion, which is how most of the energy in the universe gets generated, not just H-bombs, you know, people, oh, that's H-bombs. Well, the study I was involved with showed that you can kick particles out the back end of a fusion rocket that have 10 million times as much energy per particle as they can get in a dumb old chemical rocket. That's a big improvement. And
so that would get
furthermore,
us close to the
we
speed
now
of light,
know that almost
the
all the energy in the galaxy is produced by nuclear fusion.
So that would get us close to the speed of light, at the speed of light?
Yeah, close to. Yeah, remember, people want half an Einstein. Right. The speed of light's a limit. What he also said was, as you get close to the speed of light, time slows down for things moving that fast. How much? Well, it depends on how close you get. The particles in that large Hadron Collider over in CERN in Switzerland there, they go at 99.9999% of the speed of light.
Right.
So we know about that realm. But at just 99.9% of the speed of light, it takes only 6 months, it takes only a year to get close to the speed of light at 1G acceleration. We can stand more than that, but let's accept that. Then you can go 37 light years in 6 months pilot time.
So even
out, come back,
absent
marry your granddaughter's
some of the
best
theories
friend,
about
time
technology
down for
that
you,
we
but not,
may
not,
or may not
there.
Be able to perfect, it is possible to traverse giant distances in space.
Warp drive and wormholes and stuff like
to
that.
Traverse giant distances in space.
Well, yeah, you know, think about how long does it take to go around the planet? Well, let's see now. Magellan was the pioneer. His ship took 3 years to go around the planet. That's a good distance, a good time, right? No, the space station does it in 95 minutes. Technological progress, this is my mantra, comes from doing things differently in an unpredictable way. The future is not an extrapolation of the past. A little pocket calculator is not a better slide rule. Many people don't know what slide rules are, but we engineers and scientists use them all the time back when I started work. And a laser isn't just a better light bulb. It produces light, but entirely different physics. And so you start looking around, and especially in the solid-state physics, all these little devices that get smaller and smaller and take less and less energy come from great improvements. You can fit more and more. It doubles about every 2 years. Moore's law,
right?
The number of transistors on a chip. People 10 years ago said, oh, it's not going to keep increasing. You got smart guys making money. I was just at a conference with people from 50 countries looking into how do you make better chips and devices and all this sort of stuff. It's incredible the progress that's being made because there's so many people involved spending so much money. I mean, everywhere you go, physics is involved. You go into the restroom, you wave your hand at a little device and the towels come out. You put your hand near the faucet and the water comes out. We take it for granted. But everywhere you look, there is new technology being utilized. Now, the young people take it for granted. They don't know about slide rules. They don't care about slide rules.
So we have the broke Roswell, entered into that controversy. So the next big controversy was the ability to traverse space-time and actually get here. So you had one side of that argument. Other people had other sides. The impossibility or probability of being able to get here. And then what was the next big thing that came along?
Governments can't keep secrets. How many times have people told me that? Dr. Tyson, the head of the Hayden Planetarium, said, look, the government can't keep secrets. That's demonstrated by the fact that of how much we know about President Clinton's genitalia, as if that was a relevant thing,
yeah.
You know.
Well, it seems to me they kept the stealth program secret.
Well, the whole bunch of programs. President Eisenhower, for example, right after he came into office, in 1953, election of 52, took office in January of 53. He wanted to look at different means of containment of the Soviet Union. I thought there was too much emphasis on military. He was a man of peace, even though he was a general, you know.
Right.
And so he set up Operation Solarium, named after the place at the White House where the group met. He set up three task forces, each to look at a different mode of containment. And that set national policy. The existence of this group wasn't released until 25 years later. The Corona spy satellite, our first one, they had 12 failures in a row. This is in the late 50s. Number 13 worked. Got more data about Soviet military installations than all the U-2 flights that had preceded it. Did we brag about it? Not until 30 years later, by which time a lot of things have changed. The breaking of the German codes. There was a group of 12,000 people at Bletchley Park in England whose job it was to intercept, decode, translate, and then quietly distribute to a few important places without ever revealing that you'd broken the codes, because then they would have changed them and we'd have been in deep trouble. 12,000 people. It was 25 years after the war ended before the public was told that we'd broken the codes. That's keeping a secret. The stealth aircraft, you know, 10 years, $10 billion, kept secret.
So the idea the government can keep secrets, that people will come out and say, well, there's just no way, and they point to a lot of different things. But you're able to point to a lot of circumstances where secrets have been successfully kept for significant periods of time.
Yes, you know, 25, 30 years, what the heck. And by that time, your technology has changed, of course.
So after the debate about governments being able to keep a secret, what was the next stage and phase that strikes you as a milestone?
Well, I've given over 700 lectures. And people accept data. I present the data from Blue Book Special Report 14, from five large-scale scientific studies, et cetera. But what they really want to know are the answers to the why questions. You show them the data, that's easy to accept. I'm not creating it, somebody else did. But the why questions, why would aliens come here? Why wouldn't the government tell us what it knows? And the usual response when I give my answers, oh, I hadn't thought of it that way. Look, I'm on the stage. I've answered, I think, 60,000 questions over the years. It's not surprising that I will have thought about these things because people are going to ask them. And let me give you a couple of examples. Why would aliens come here? Well, in one of my books, I've got 20 reasons for coming here. Maybe it's to quarantine us. We're a threat to the neighborhood. We've exploded 2,000 nuclear weapons. In World War II, we killed 50 million people. We destroyed 1,700 cities. We're not nice guys. You know, why don't they land and talk to the president? Come on, that's ridiculous. Every Air Force on the planet would love to grab itself a flying saucer to try to duplicate it, you know, for military application. The budget on the planet is military budget is $1 trillion this year. Look how many kids died yesterday of preventable disease or starvation. You know, so we're nasty guys. So that's one reason. Another is, this will sound strange, but the Earth happens to be the densest planet in the solar system. A cubic foot of Earth weighs more than a cubic foot of any of the other planets. And you say, so what? I mean, Saturn, incidentally, this guy, if you had a big enough bucket of water, you could float Saturn. That's how low density it is. Now, being the densest means there's more heavy metals here. And heavy metals are rare in the universe. Things like that nobody's ever heard of, osmium, rhenium, stuff like that. Osmium is twice as dense as lead, for example. And they have very special properties. So for all I know, they've been mining the good stuff here. You know, I ask people, what do you think uranium was used for 100 years ago? They don't know. Well, it was used primarily as a coloring agent, yellow coloring agent for tableware. That's illegal now.
Right.
But that's not the same as making weapons from it.
Right.
You know, or counterweights for airplane wings. Uranium is very dense, one of these crazy metals. Another possibility, graduate students doing their thesis work on the development of a primitive society. And maybe this was a penal colony. They dumped all the bad boys and girls here, and that's why we're so nasty to each other. The Australians are very happy about their convict ancestors, you know. So you can, you know, why do people travel? I do a lot of airplane travel, and the people aren't at the terminals all for the same reason. There are all kinds of different reasons. Right. Quarantining us, I think, would be an important one. Because if I were an alien, I wouldn't want us out there. We're nasty.
You know, it's interesting. I have this discussion with a lot of people about why we're not going to have disclosure, formal disclosure, and why perhaps any extraterrestrial presence is going to be reluctant to officially reveal itself. And my personal opinion about it is that, you know, humanity as a whole has a long way to go. And we have these little pockets of our civilization where, you know, it's like the people in LA going to the yoga class and meditating and thinking about what an enlightened species we're becoming. But until while we still have ISIS and we still have children in Africa killing their parents and their families, while we still have these extremely dysfunctional facets of our society, we are not going to be ready as a species to be allowed into a broader galactic family. And so, you know, quarantine, and it certainly makes a lot of sense to keep us quarantined so we either graduate or destroy ourselves.
Yeah.
And so I think that, you know, that's probably one of the biggest reasons why they're not revealing themselves, and probably one of the biggest
reasons. Well, they know we know they're here. After you've been tracked on radar 5,000 times, you know that the guys down there know you're there.
Now, where do you stand on the whole ancient alien theory, that humanity was actually genetically engineered by extraterrestrials for whatever purpose?
Well, I would point to the book, The Bible and Flying Saucers, by Dr. Barry Downing. He's got a bachelor's in physics and a doctor of divinity, divine mm-hmm. physics is his
right.
beat. And he traces what you'd have to call flying saucer sightings. Nobody had saucers back then. They had mugs, but, you know, they didn't call them that.
No, I mean, the whole book of Genesis, you know, is full of, if you translate a couple of words, change them to different things, it's a whole story.
Well, that's a few thousand years.
Yeah.
So, I don't know whether we were developed by aliens, but it's the time factor. Pat Robertson, the fundamentalist, says that the world was created in 4004 BC, and we're the only intelligent life in the universe.
Right.
They're right here on planet Earth, and this UFO stuff is the work of the devil. I'm sorry, I beg to differ. There's a big time factor. Grand Canyon up there took quite a long time, more than 6,000 years. Henrik Schliemann looked for back in the 19th century, looked at the Iliad, Homer's Iliad. And the historian said, well, there was no Troy. That's just a myth. It's just in a book. He had money. He paid people to dig down 75 feet, and he found Troy. How much of the planet have we explored 75 feet? And that was just a few thousand years ago.
No, exactly.
We don't know how many civilizations
have come and gone. So
the real
history of Earth, could be, you know, very, very old, with very many civilizations rising and falling, and there are traces of
asteroid them being literally. Comes along and destroys, all kinds of things, nuclear wars, whatever. I don't think there have been any black holes or, supernovas, really.
Right.
Explode, not recently and close by, but maybe a little farther away and a little while back. We don't know. But as soon as you expose the time factor, you say there's all kinds of possibilities. So I think that there have been ancient astronauts coming here. I think the neighborhood, what people forget, is at least 2,000 stars within 54 light years. That's a lot. That's just down the street, the Betty and Barney Hill case with the star map work that goes into that. Just 39 light years away, there are two sun-like stars that are only an eighth of a light year apart. They're 30 times closer to each other than the sun is to the next star over. From planet around one looking at the other, it's visible all day long.
Right.
We can't do that. Well, there's much more incentive to develop interstellar travel when you got a next door neighbor. Just makes sense, that's all.
And just with the age of the galaxy and the number, I mean, even mainstream science now is not debating the idea that there's life in outer space. And we'll
they're saying it's not coming here because they would know about it because they want to listen with radio telescopes.
Which could be a completely obsolete technology that doesn't even apply to
species. Well, our first long-distance radio signal was sent in 1901. You're telling me that's the most advanced the aliens ever got? You know, that they're stuck at our level of technology? That's ridiculous. So I think we need to get off our egos. And what's going on is beyond what we've been able to do. That doesn't mean it's beyond what lots of theys probably have been able to do. And I think there is a galactic federation. And one of the things that strikes me is the fact that a number of missiles with nuclear weapons on their nose have gone down when the UFO was close by. Robert Sala has written a book about this. He was down in the hole. And 10 missiles went down one after the other. That's impossible, but it happened. And so somebody's paying attention.
Yeah, there's a huge body of evidence, and a lot of people have gone public regarding nuclear tampering. At the Citizen Hearing on Disclosure, there was a whole segment devoted to it.
Yeah, I was there. Not at the missile sites, but at the,
right,
the hearing.
At the hearing, sure.
So somebody's paying attention. It happened in the Soviet Union. It went the reverse way. Suddenly, a bunch of missiles went online, ready to go. And they had to be shut down by the officer who was there. Just the reverse kind of thing. So I would expect them to be concerned. Not because they're nice guys, but because there are certain rules of behavior. We're primitive, and we act nastily whenever we can. And, you know, I worry about what's the world going to be like when my 8-year-old great-grandson grows up, and I look at what goes on in the world today. It's not a pretty picture.
Now, there are people that would say that if you look at the per capita level of violence in our modern world versus how people lived in the Middle Ages and, you know, going further and further back, that there's a good, strong body of evidence that humanity as a whole is evolving to a more kind, gentle, and less warlike species. What do you say to that?
I would say what they're evolving to is the use of technology to kill more people more effectively.
But do you think that's actually happening? I mean, certainly we have this technology to do those kind of things, but do you see us actually doing it? I mean, we have nukes, but we're not using them. We have...
2,000 have been exploded on this planet, besides the two on people.
Yeah.
And any of these places?
But the fact that even in these most extreme states, there's still some level of restraint. You know, the crazy man has not pushed the button yet. And even though we have the capability of destroying ourselves way more than we've ever had in the past, it seems to be that maybe we won't.
The problem to me is that we keep forgetting how much the population has grown, how much we're utilizing the resources of the planet, and how much pressure there is for the have-nots to get what the haves have. And there's more of that pressure all the time. The population hasn't gone down. We're multiplying quite rapidly on this planet, and the planet's resources are being tampered with, so to speak. And whether it's global warming or anything else you want to talk about, we're getting closer to trouble rather than to, isn't it great? Bliss is not on the horizon, as far as I can tell. So I think that we need to stand back. And one of the reasons, one of the other why questions is, why doesn't the government tell us what it knows? And I think there are at least five reasons. First, you want to figure out how the darn things work. I'm not saying fear of panic, you know, the Orson Welles routine. Every Air Force on the planet would love to grab a flying saucer to build one like it and so forth. Rule number one for security, you can't tell your friends without telling your enemies. In other words, we have wreckage, you send it to the right classified places to try to figure out what's going on. But you don't tell the public that. You can't. You can't tell your friends without telling your enemies. Second problem, what if the other guy figures out how they work before you do? How do you defend against them? You don't want them to know, you know, they know. Weapon, counter-weapon, counter-counter-weapon. We've been playing these games as spears and shields, you know. There's a third problem, hypothesis. Suppose two highly trusted individuals on the planet were to come forth and say that indeed the planet's being visited by aliens. Let's say the Queen and the Pope. That's sort of an odd couple, but
sure.
Why
be as good as any.
What would happen? Church attendance would go up, mental hospital admissions would go up, stock market would go down because uncertainty is always.
So just major social disruption all the way
yes.
around. Right.
But one of the biggest parts of that nobody wants to talk about. That is, I believe the younger generation would push for a new view of ourselves instead of as Americans, Canadians, Greeks, Peruvians, Chinese, whatever, as Earthlings. I mean, it's obvious from an alien view, but we are all Earthlings.
Right.
Do you know of any government on this planet that wants its citizens to owe their allegiance to the planet instead of that individual government? Nationalism is the only game in town that I've been able to find.
Well, I mean, you know, anybody who follows conspiracy theory even remotely knows that there's a globalist agenda to bring about a one world government.
Well, that's a popular notion. But I'm saying, considering the new technology and the needs of the planet and the environment, we need to start thinking of ourselves as Earthlings.
Species.
But
Absolutely.
We don't know how to convert from where we are. How do you get there? Who's going to say, well, I'm ready? Who speaks for
the planet?
I think
there's a lot of people that are working on that. And you know, as much as I am going to get dogged for saying it, I think that the whole idea of global standards, global human rights, global administration is not a bad idea. It's how a planet should be run. So the people that think that the new world order and the government coming and turning this into a one world government or at least a one world family is such a bad thing. If it was done right, it's really the logical progression of human governance and something that we need to accomplish here on the planet in order to move forward. And so it's not a big, bad, dark concept. It's
but
something
people
that
in
makes
power
sense.
Don't want to give up power.
So, you know, here's something that I like to talk about, and that is the spiritual implications of all of this. Do you believe in life after death?
Yes, I do. And I think it would be astonishing to me if the advanced civilizations out there don't know a lot more about these, quote, paranormal phenomena. One of them being reincarnation. Look, I've listened to a tape of a gal under hypnosis reliving being taken through a wall. And the total astonishment in her voice, you know, how did that happen? kind of thing. There was a wall and she went right on through it. Telepathy, they seem to communicate telepathically. Now, we like to poo-poo that, we quote scientists.
Right.
And in the book, Science Was Wrong, my writing partner, Kathleen Martin, has a whole chapter on all the published in scientific journals studies that show that this stuff goes on, controls and everything, but where the scientists don't want to admit it.
You know, that's a field that I'm doing a lot of work in right now. I call it the quantum paranormal. And the reason I say that is because, you know, I look forward to the day when science can explain with a formula the existence of intelligence design, or that when neuroscientists actually acknowledge that consciousness survives the brain.
So near-death experiences.
Near-death experiences, which seem to be, you know, a lot of people trying to debunk that, but there's a lot of studies out there that are really starting to make sense.
I don't know how to do it. Can't be. That's
right, exactly.
Attitude.
So as a scientist, you see the door opening to newer theories in
sure.
quantum mechanics helping to explain what was traditionally thought of impossible phenomena?
That's been the history of mankind in the last 100 years. We begin to accept things which we thought were impossible. Like I say, in our book, we have a whole bunch of things that the big shot said couldn't possibly be, but that turned out to have been. We take for granted now. And so I'm an optimist on that account. I mean, I'm an old guy, but I remember how much things have changed. And remember, technological progress comes from doing things differently in an unpredictable way. And anybody who wants to deny that is doomed to be wrong, because that's the whole history of the planet.
That's the whole history, yep.
Yeah. And so, yeah, I think we're going to be finding new things. And I think that we need to recognize our own limits of our thinking, if you will.
Or just our ability to comprehend and our brain's ability to process the information.
Yes, and things are possible even if we don't understand how they're done. Look at the many great discoveries made by people who said, what the heck is going on here? Maybe penicillin, the x-rays. Strange phenomena, which had no explanation. The guy who was measuring radiation above the surface of the Earth, and he thought it's all coming from the Earth, radioactive materials and stuff. And as he got up higher, the level went up. That didn't make any sense. The farther you are from the planet, should go down. He discovered cosmic rays.
Right.
Meteorites. Everybody knows rocks can't fall from the sky because you can see there are no rocks in the sky. Well, further work when people finally saw them come down and grabbed them and found out they were different, et cetera, et cetera. All kinds of bad assumptions have been made because of our unwillingness to say, I don't know, but that doesn't mean it's not real. Let's check. Let's do some experiments. Let's do some measurements. And the history of science I find fascinating. The people who had the guts enough to pursue the strange and discover the new, that's exciting to me. That's what science should be all about as far as I'm concerned anyway. So, you know, I'm not saying I'm going to make any great discoveries. I'm a little old for that. But I have to respect the fact that it's happened over and over and over again in medicine, in physics, in chemistry. All kinds of new phenomena that were there all the time. Look, we didn't discover the neutron until 1932. That doesn't mean there weren't neutrons here before that. It means we didn't know about them.
But Stanton, what you have done is something that very few people in the scientific community ever find the courage to do. And that is that you've taken a stand on something that you intuitively and through your research know to be correct, even though it could be scientifically argued at this point based on the current evidence. And as a person with the scientific background, you bring a level of credibility to this field that very few other people have ever managed to achieve.
Well, I appreciate you saying
that.
And
this is an amazing legacy that you bring to this, because there's going to come a time when people are saying, well, you know, Stanton Friedman was right, and Stanton Friedman had the nerve to do this and the nerve to say this.
I hope so.
And it's going to prove to be, you know,
I'm more excited about that
as time progresses.
Because we need to be ready to look at truth. And, you know, don't tell me how many degrees somebody has. Show me his work. What's he published? What has he done? Smartest guy I ever worked for at Aerojet General Nucleonics, John Luce. He ran the fusion work at Oak Ridge National Laboratory. Had a high school diploma, 40 patents, and an honorary PhD. No college at all. And he was always doing things that the PhDs that worked for him said couldn't be done. So I respect that. I enjoyed working with John, and he knew people too, which was a good thing, good guy to work for. So we all need to recognize that even though we're so advanced, there are new things to be discovered. Sorry, that's the way it is. We haven't come to an end yet.
I've been a fan of the unified field theory debate. And I just recently had Nassim Harman in, who says that he has discovered the missing pieces of the unified field. And I'm always saying that I don't really think they're going to be able to come up with one that works, because there's too many variables when you get down to a quantum level that allows reality to basically cheat the system in order to work. So you can't come up with a solid mathematical formula when there's variables that allow for, no matter what the solid mathematical formula is, we get to a certain point, we can do what we want. We have quantum photosynthesis that shows us that something's going on, that where photons can travel in all these different directions at the same time.
Entanglement.
We have quantum
like
entanglement that shows us that things can traverse faster than the speed of light. So how do you think that the progression of these theories is going to affect our evolution as a species?
I think more young people will be making more discoveries of new ways to dig into reality, that we have not made all the discoveries there are to be made. And I think when I talk about nuclear fusion, for example, I know about nuclear fusion. I know the stars are fusioning.
Right.
But there are other techniques that I can think of that may be even better. But I don't know how to do anything about them now. And it's good enough for the moment. So progress comes from doing things differently. And we need to recognize that and not pump down on those who come up with new ideas. So many of the ancient academics and fossilized physicists are afraid to even think about new stuff because, gee, somebody's going to say that I'm interested in crazy stuff.
Right.
A lot of good stuff that was thought to be crazy.
Now, is that changing in science, though? It seems as though the doorway to acceptance of pursuing these esoteric concepts is a lot more accepted than it used to be. I mean, you're not going to lose your reputation as a scientist for asking certain questions as much as you might have been in the past.
I think there has been a change, but I think there is growing recognition that there's an awful lot of good stuff going on outside of academia. The academic community thinks all research gets done in academia. The reality is a lot of it doesn't get done there, and many great discoveries, especially with technological implications, are done outside academia.
Especially with more and more groups being able to interact via the web. You know, the Millennium Project has 50 global nodes all collectively studying world challenges. And so it just shows that you don't need that structure of academia to put together a structure of discovery.
Well, that's right. I was just at a conference in San Diego, an international electronics conference. There were people from 50 countries there, all kinds of new and fancy equipment there. And they're talking to each other, sharing information, and they're moving forward. And they're willing to forget their petty differences. Supposed enemies talk to each other because they're interested in the challenge. And, you know, you can say it's the profit motive. I'm not a psychologist. I won't get into that. But I do know that there's a lot going on, like I say, outside of academia, and where the job is not publish or perish. It's get the job done.
So, Stanton, well after the release of your work going public, an ex-military official named Philip Corso published The Day After Roswell. And I understand that you take exception to the information in that book and literally the whole story.
Yes, I do. I've met him. I was there in Roswell when the book was released. And I believe in checking on claims. For example, one of the claims in there is that he was a member of Ike's National Security Council. Well, having been at the Eisenhower Library, I called them and asked about what they have on him and so forth. And two important things. He never attended a meeting and he was never a member of the National Security Council. And I sent their results to the lawyer to whom he had made this sworn statement, who showed it to him and said, "Don't you think we ought to take that out?" No, he didn't care. You know that Strom Thurmond, who supposedly wrote the foreword for his book,
he pulled it out
because he thought it was for a different book. It was people in his office found, you know, it doesn't compute kind of thing. We did a radio appearance. I was in one place, he was in another, and the host was someplace else. And he's talking about what happened at Fort Riley in Kansas, where his bowling buddy lets him look at a body in a blue fluid.
Right, yeah, it's a completely different, totally coincidental thing that has nothing to do with his official position.
Well, a strong violation of security. If you got an alien body, you don't let it anybody from outside,
yeah,
hey, look what I got, kind of thing. He also gave the date. It was July 6th, 47. I asked him, do you have a diary or notes or something? Because I was hoping maybe he did have some
kind
basis.
Of something, yeah.
No, I know when I was transferred there. Well, it turns out that was March or April. And the date just doesn't match what we know about when the rancher came into Roswell and so forth.
Right.
Furthermore, if there's one thing Roswell had, it was airplanes. That's what it was.
Right.
Why would they put stuff on a truck and go through Fort Riley instead of flying stuff directly to Wright Field? It makes no sense, besides the security things. Also, he didn't become part of General Trudeau's Foreign Technology Division at the Pentagon, Army General, until 1960. Well, we know that the Air Force Foreign Technology Division, with whom I had business dealings.
Yeah, you were part of that.
Yeah, I worked with those guys. Very impressed with them. Very bunch of sharp guys. We know they had wreckage in 1947. You mean to tell me somebody waited until 1960? Well, a couple of things that he took credit for.
The technological advances.
Yeah, right. One of them, a guy got a Nobel Prize for work done 2 years before Corso was involved in that stuff. I checked the Army archives in Fort Carlisle, Pennsylvania, and got the roster of Trudeau's group. Two guys in the Foreign Technology group. He was the junior officer. I found the other one, but he was in the hospital and died. But there were all kinds of engineers and scientists at the Air Force Foreign Technology Division. And so you notice there are no references in the book. So how do you follow how a guy who was not an engineer or a scientist, and he wasn't,
right,
would somehow do all of this kind of stuff? I mean, he had a long list of things that he brought into the industry, he said, but I've seen no basis for that.
Every piece of technology that he says was ported to private industry and came out the other side, private industry has come back and said, no, we had that stuff in development and that it had nothing to do with that.
I consider him a wannabe. Nice old man. I met him. He wasn't a nasty person or something like that. He wanted to leave a legacy for his kids. And I don't blame anybody for that. But I do believe in sticking to the truth.
You know what's interesting, and not that many people know this about Corso, I dug it up in some research that I was doing, is that he was shopping a book before The Day After Roswell, and I think I told you this when we talked on the phone, you might have known it before, called I Walked with Giants,
yes.
Where it was basically describing his Forrest Gump-like odyssey through the high levels of military and Pentagon and everything and all of the people around him, and nobody wanted that book. And so on some level, some publisher came to him and said, look, if you want to get published, if you want to leave a book behind, we need something better than that. And so who knows if that
got
him
thinking. That's
where
Bill Burns came into the picture. He's an author.
Yeah. So who knows where, if that got Corso thinking, and if he decided, you know, okay, well, I can come up with something, or if there's, you know, grains of truth in it. But I agree with you that the knowing that one fact and all the other glitches in his story and all the other inconsistencies, it really pulls into question the day after Roswell. And it's sad, yes, because it's one of those things that you really want to believe.
Look, I was there when the book was released. I was supposed to get an advance copy, as a matter of fact, but I didn't. No, nice old man, and I think most of it's a fantasy. Remember that he also said J. Edgar Hoover was his buddy, and a researcher named Larry Bryant, checked his FBI file, and Hoover calls him a rat. He was making a big fuss about troops left behind in Korea and their political sort of stuff.
Right.
And there are others who disagree with them and stuff. So I'm just not impressed that he had a contribution to make. I'm not saying he's a bad person or anything. That's not the point.
Right.
Is he telling the truth is the point. And that's where I have problems. Because I found enough things to say that's simply not true. To say that why should I believe anything else if I find a number of statements that aren't true?
So another person who's brought up the ET technology and stories that really play into the modern day mythos is the story of Bob Lazar.
Yes.
And that's another one that you take extreme exception to.
Yes, I do. Robert Scott Lazar, bright guy, built a jet powered car, did other interesting things. And I first heard about him at 1989 at the MUFON conference where George Knapp, a fine reporter for the television station in Las Vegas, brought the story forth. And because he was being called a nuclear physicist with a master's degree in physics from MIT and another master in electronics from Caltech, two of the top universities
in the
country.
And these were his claims, right?
Yes.
Yeah.
And that was one of the reasons people were believing him. But I got asked about him because they know I'm a nuclear physicist. I've been talking about that for a long time. And so I decided I better check before I stand behind him. So I called five different people at MIT. The registrar, the standard place where you get this kind of information, and the guy who collects the master's theses, and the physics department, and the legal counsel, nobody ever heard of him. Now, I asked, and somebody went through the yearbooks.
Couldn't find him anywhere.
Couldn't find him anywhere. And I asked the legal counsel, is it possible to completely wipe out somebody from the books? And he said, no, you're in just an awful lot of places.
Right.
And how can I argue with him?
Well, I mean, you know, the whole idea that Lazar's previous background had been somehow covered up by some shadowy government force, it's impossible to go to every yearbook in every chest of drawers and eliminate a picture to the
That's
point.
That's right.
Yeah, so it doesn't make any sense.
And there were other things. For example, the listing in the Los Alamos phone book says K/M after his name, Kirk Meyer. It was a consulting outfit. And they provided warm bodies, if you will, out at the Clinton D. Anderson Maison Accelerator Facility. It's got an even longer name than that.
Right.
And he apparently was a technician out there. That's not working for the lab, Los Alamos. It's working for
A subcontractor. Could have been janitorial, for all we know.
Everybody out there has to have a clearance.
Right.
I've been there. I'm business, you know. If you sweep the floor, you got to have a clearance because you might see something. You know. At a meeting in Rachel, Nevada, the Little Ely Inn, the infamous little restaurant, he was answering questions, and somebody asked, can you name any of your professors? Legitimate question. I can name mine, and I'm a lot older than he is.
Sure.
And so he said, well, let's see now. Bill Duxler, he'll remember me from Caltech Physics. Well, I checked my directory of the American Physical Society, in which Bob is not listed, and I found Bill Duxler, and I called him, explained to him that his name was being used. Well, it turns out he never taught at Caltech, which is a very prestigious university, incidentally. Instead, he talked at Pierce Junior College, which is close by, less than 50 miles away in the valley, but doesn't have the same intellectual clout that Caltech does. He was angry that somebody was using his name, so he checked, and Bob had taken a course, night school course at Pierce Junior College, in the very same year when he was supposedly at MIT, 2,500 miles away. If you go to MIT, you don't go to Pierce Junior College. Now, I checked his high school. George Knapp gave me the name of his high school, and I called, and can I check, because I'm getting different stories? And she said, yeah, call me back, I'll take out his files. George knew the year. New York, Long Island, a high school out there. And I'm talking to her on the phone, and she says, let's see now. He graduated in August, not with his class. That raised a little question mark. Maybe he flunked a course. I mean, this is a guy who went to MIT, you know.
Right.
I said, well, okay. He did take a lot of science courses, didn't he? Chemistry. What else? Chemistry. Now I'm beginning to get real suspicious. And I have a personal involvement here. I was accepted by MIT out of high school.
Right.
I couldn't afford to go. $950 a year for tuition, you know, now it's $25,000 or
yeah,
something,
no kidding.
You know. But I was valedictorian in my high school class. So I decided to ask a question, which was kind of loaded. Well, he was valedictorian, wasn't he? He never claimed that.
Right.
And she laughs and said, no, he wasn't. Was he in the top 10? No. Top 50? No. She's laughing. Top 100? No. And she told me that he was like 268 out of 367, something
wow.
like that, bottom third of his class. One of the things I talked to the admissions department about, can you get in with that kind of background? Because they get applications from all over the world.
Right.
You know. And the answer was absolutely not. You got to be less than 20% in a class. In other words, maybe 10% they'll take you. 20 they probably won't. And bottom third, never. There are too many applicants. Why would you waste your space, you know? So that was an interesting conversation. Furthermore, Caltech never heard of him. And another claim that he made was that Los Alamos had gathered 500 pounds of element 115. Now, all those transuranic higher atomic number than uranium mm-hmm. elements, almost all of them are radioactive. And yes, element 115, operating a big accelerator, they've made four atoms of this stuff by operating it for weeks. Four atoms, you need 10 to the 23rd, 10 followed by 23 zero, more atoms than that to do anything useful. There's no, and the half-life is less than a minute, much less, but let's just say it's less than 2 minutes, doesn't matter.
So what exactly is he saying about element 115, that it was used as a fuel to?
Yeah, gravity wave amplifiers, and he didn't repeat that claim about 500 pounds anymore, because
right.
it's absurd. There's no way to collect some 500 pounds of something that has a half-life less than a minute, or 2 minutes, or 10 minutes, it doesn't matter.
So when we get into his physics, first let's talk about his background. So obviously his stated background doesn't even check out.
No.
Even way beyond the idea that maybe somebody went and just erased his past after he started talking.
Right.
There's just nothing about what he said as his major educational milestones that will bear scrutiny.
I was asked by his friend, Gene Huff, this is years ago, what would it take to convince you that Bob is telling the truth? It was a friendly conversation. It wasn't
sure.
nasty. I said, well, let's see. Copies of his diplomas, a resume, a listing of his membership and professional groups, papers that he's written, stuff like that. Thesis title, because you need a master's thesis at MIT.
Right.
I didn't need one at the University of Chicago to get a master's in physics. But I sent him copies of my diplomas, an
right.
eight-page resume, listings and directories of the American Physical Society, American Nuclear Society, American Institute of Aeronautics and Astronautics, alumni directory from the University of Chicago. Now, don't tell me you get a degree from MIT and another one from Caltech and you throw it away? Come on. People don't do that. I've got my diplomas and one of them's on the wall, but
sure.
So that was another thing. And I sent him my stuff, but I never got anything back.
So his background doesn't check out. And then when we get into his actual story, I mean, the idea that there was this S4 place where they had these flying saucers in secret hangars.
Maybe.
Yeah, that's certainly feasible. But then when he starts to explain the physics of what he was supposed to work on, that all falls apart too, right?
My conclusion is it does. I mean, I saw him the other day where he talked about the pressure when you put your hand near this. There's a dome over a box. Nobody has shown a job title for him that says he was a scientist. Technician, yes, he was a smart guy. Good with his hands. I got nothing against technicians. But I do have something about somebody who lies about these things.
Right.
Now, I'm not saying there aren't vehicles out at S4.
Right.
And I'm not saying we're not trying to figure out how they work.
Right.
But what was his involvement? What does he add to the story? He's never published a paper. He doesn't belong to any professional groups. It's an interesting story.
So do you think there's anything true about his story? Did he see something at S4? Did he get to S4?
I think he probably did. I think he may have been repairing radiation detectors, something that he did on the side.
Right.
So that wouldn't surprise me. But what does that add to the story? Yes, there are all kinds of classified activities out at S4, Area 51, whatever you want to call that whole business. And the big claim is that he took people out to see a flight several weeks running, 3 weeks, I think.
Sure, and they say, well, if his story's not true, how did he know to go there?
Yeah, and if he knew anybody who worked out there and they said, hey, we're testing on Wednesday night.
Right.
8 o'clock. And that he got caught out there seems very strange.
Right.
And we don't know that what he saw was alien as opposed to ours.
Right.
Plenty of classified work going out there. I worked under security. And yes, the government is entitled to do classified work all over the place. And it does.
So is there any kind of takeaway from the Lazar story, or do you just think the whole thing's completely fabricated? And or beyond that, is it possible that it's just some sort of disinformation program and he's just an agent for disinformation?
Well, I would leave room for that. I can't prove that that didn't happen, that
right.
He's not a disinformation agent.
What does your gut tell you?
My gut tells me he's not telling the truth about his involvement. As I watched him describe what he did out at the facility, mm-hmm. and I talked to half a dozen people after his presentation, and they were scientists, and they all told me he just doesn't sound like a scientist the way he describes things.
None of the people with scientific backgrounds, they just walked out of the room shaking their heads.
Yeah.
Now, why do you think that even to this day, that George Knapp seems to have a certain level of support for the story?
Well, because George is caught. George is a darn good journalist. He's broken lots of stories.
Right.
And because he got to know Bob, and maybe he was influenced by John Lear, I don't know. But I found that there were some areas where George wasn't as up as he might have been, just because it wasn't in his background. He thought if you worked out there at Los Alamos in the phone book, you were a scientist. No, if you had a clearance, that made you a scientist. No,
right, no.
The floor sweeper has to have a clearance.
It takes a lot of people to run a facility like
that. And so I think George stuck his neck out. And I admire his guts in talking about the story at all.
Right.
But he wasn't in a good position to verify. And look, he gave me the name of the high school. I told him the findings. He made out a request for Bob to send in to get a transcript of his high school records.
Right.
And Bob signed it, and it was sent in, but Bob said he never got a response from the high school. I'm a little suspicious about that, let's put it.
Now, why do you think that, you know, as a journalist, and I have a lot of respect for George Knapp, so I have no interest in saying anything that would disparage him in any way, but why would he want to participate in bringing Bob Lazar back in front of audiences after all these years, knowing that there's so many questions?
Because people have pushed him to do it. And you saw there was a huge crowd there.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of interest. I don't know how many copies of the video got sold, but on the DVD,
I'm
sure it was a lot.
The Lazar story is a story that if you believe in this mythos, if you believe in the whole thing that happened with Roswell, it's a story that people want to believe. It's a logical progression from what happened, and it fits so well. So there's a reason that a lot of people are, as Chris O'Brien would say, drinking the Kool-Aid. But it doesn't change the fact that you know, the story doesn't add up. And as much as, you know, I wanted to believe Lazar, and I've looked at it, and I've spoken with you, and I've spoken with a lot of other people, and there's very little of this story that makes any sense. Maybe he got out there, maybe he saw something. You know, why would you hire a guy that's making rockets out of cars to go look at one of the most classified situations in world
Good
history?
Question.
And people say, well, because he's a think outside the box guy. He was strapping rocket engines to cars. So they looked at him and said, well, here's a guy that might give us a different angle, right?
Hard to imagine, yes.
And so you have two completely different camps, and it seems like there's no in between.
There doesn't seem to be. So, you know, I was impressed watching him. It's the first time I've had a chance to watch him talk for a long period of time.
Sure.
And nobody else has had a chance to do that either. And I tried to meet with him back 20-some years ago.
Sure.
When I was going to Vegas and I was going to set up lunch, but it didn't work out. So I wasn't trying to put him down right from the start, but I was getting asked that I'm not going to support somebody if I can't get answers.
Right.
You know, and especially I know that people knowing that I'm a nuclear physicist, if I said I believe him, that would lead an awful lot of people to believe him too. So I have a responsibility.
You have a responsibility to the science.
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah.
So how did that feel? Because it's no secret to the people that are really active in the field that you have been, you know, in opposition to the Lazar story for a long time. And you were there and Lazar was there. And, you know, it seemed as though there was almost a tension in the air that there was a certain amount of energy.
My name got mentioned on the stage a couple of times. You may
How did that make you feel?
Well, I'm glad they acknowledged it, but I had submitted a bunch of questions to be posed to him, if you were submitted to him, as they said.
Right.
None of them got submitted. So I was disappointed. But I think, I won't call it a cover-up, I just went right by the truth kind of thing. And so I think if you're going to make claims like that, if I can't believe what you claim, why should I believe anything you say?
Right.
And what did he add to the picture? I talked to a guy, this is years ago, who worked at a radio station in Berkeley, who interviewed Bob and had with him a scientist from Stanford, not announcing who he was, who would occasionally ask questions about physics, and he couldn't answer any of them. Mm-hmm. And that guy said to the guy who interviewed him, how much you want to bet he doesn't show up tomorrow? They're supposed to do 2 days of these things. And
right.
He didn't.
Right.
He didn't. So that bothers me. You're tainting my field, darn it.
Right.
You know, that's what it happens. I'm not saying there weren't any saucers. I'm not saying there isn't stuff at S4, although 10 seems like an excess. What do you say? 10 a sport model and 9 others or something
yeah,
like that.
Yeah.
That seems rather excessive. Where do we get all those?
Right.
And intact, apparently.
Sure. Well, you know, the mythos says that we struck a secret deal and we traded for them.
Why would you have Bob do the work?
And if you were able to get the aliens to give you a bunch of flying saucers, why do you need anybody like Bob anyway? Aren't they going to teach you how to work them?
Yeah, I would think
right.
So. So it's a mystery. And as I say, I didn't wind up disliking the man, but I don't think he's telling the whole truth. And it's unfortunate. It is fouled up the air, so to speak. You know, show me a diploma, then I believe you.
But it just seems as though dishonesty is destroying the legitimate research, and when the truth really comes out, it's going to be so diluted that it's going to be impossible to tell what's really happening. The aliens could land on the White House lawn and we're going to say it was a holographic projection by HARP technology. So, I mean, there's no win situation happening, and deception is a big part of it.
And that's why I felt it was necessary for me to do some digging. And what bothers me is nobody else does the digging. You know, who talked to Bob's high school besides me? Who talked to MIT? You know, that's what I'm saying. If you don't believe me, show me.
I have learned that the bigger the claim, the more due diligence you have to do.
Yeah.
And so, you know, if somebody comes and says, well, yeah, I have this college education, and you're hiring them for a job, well, you're going to do a little due diligence, but you might not completely research them. But if somebody says something as big as what Lazar has said, then yeah, there's a need to do this. And then, you know, you've gotten a certain amount of flack for a feeling like you needed to go in and dig that deep. It's like, why are you looking into it like that? Why wouldn't anybody? And why are so many people so gullible that they want to believe this stuff with and that they consider other people's actions to verify facts to be aggressive?
Well, you know, there was another person that claimed to have a degree from the Air Force Academy, a prestigious place. And he didn't strike me as being the kind of person who would have. So I called and talked to the registrar. And no, he hadn't graduated from there. And I asked, do you get a lot of questions about people who didn't go there? All the time.
All the time.
We're a prestigious place, she said. People like to add it to their resume. That's the way life is. And so I'm sorry about that, but, you know, that's why I sent Gene Huff copies of my diplomas.
Well, I think it just adds to the reasons why humanity's not ready for some sort of membership in a galactic civilization, because we're not going to be able to lie our way to Jupiter.
We don't qualify for the cosmic kindergarten, frankly.
No, I don't think so. I think, we're a long way off. So Stanton, I really appreciate you taking the time to talk to me. We've covered a lot of ground, and I'm sure that once this piece gets out, people are going to have something to say about it, which is fine. I appreciate you opening up and talking to us about some of the things that you believe.
Harry Truman said, if you can't stand the heat, get out of the kitchen. That's how I feel. If I can't stand being questioned.
And after this long interview,
I shouldn't do
we're
it.
Headed for the kitchen. Thank you.
Thanks. We'll be right back.